Councilmember Bangs, vacation. Is there a motion to excuse?
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor, raise your hand and say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Okay. We're in our study session format this evening. So we take comments from the public, but they're related to the issues that are on the agenda. Is there anybody who's signed up? Okay. All right. And we will get into our discussion items for the evening. The first is emerging issues. These are issues that come up. Some of them are issues that may develop over a period of time, period of years, and we're getting an early warning on those issues or what's developing with them. Others are things that just emerged today.
Yes, one is one that emerged today. So I actually have three items very quickly. First of all, with the passage of the transportation package in the legislature early this year, the 509 extension has been funded. So WashDOT is starting their process to get that project going. Staff has interacted with WashDOT staff several times over the last few weeks, and we were just notified a few days ago that WashDOT is planning to do an open house at Highline College on December 17th from 4 to 7 p.m. I don't have the exact location. Hopefully we'll get that soon. We will then let council know. We'll post that on our website. They also gave us a couple of very preliminary drawings of what the interchange might look like at the 509 extension and Kent Des Moines Road, which were part of an email I forwarded to council. And we'll get this information posted on our website as well. So I guess the takeaway on this is here we go. Second, the mayor alluded to a issue that popped up today. We received a public records request from an individual who has filed a similar public records request with every city in King County. And essentially what he has asked for is every record we have. Every single record, paper record, electronic record, emails, metadata, text messages, everything. And, of course, that's hundreds of thousands of documents, thousands and thousands of hours of staff time retrieving them. However, at this point, we need to take this request seriously. We've asked staff and council, I think we sent it to you as well, please don't destroy any record that you have, even if it's the text messages that go back and forth between you and staff or between yourselves. You might be saying, I'll meet you at Annie Irene's for coffee. He even calls out in his request that simple acknowledgments of we're going to have lunch this afternoon are things he wants to have in his public records request. He very nicely put it that he wants it in 9 installments, and he lists out what he wants in each installment, and the 9th installment is everything else that I haven't gotten yet. So I can tell you the clerks have been talking back and forth, having conference calls. The city attorneys have been calling, talking about what we're going to do about this.
How many cities did he submit?
There are 39 cities in King County, and as far as we know, he's hit them all. I do know that Burien got theirs yesterday. Oh, no, I'm sorry, the day before. Seattle has gotten it. Seattle was the first one. If you recall, this was a gentleman who had made a public records request about a year ago asking for text messages and emails and the like from all cities in the state. Seattle was working with him, and they offered him a job to come and work in their IT department, and one of the things he agreed to do by accepting that job was to withdraw his public records requests to all the cities, which he did. Well, evidently, a few months ago, there was a parting of the ways. One way or another, I'm not sure exactly how it happened, and he no longer works for the city of Seattle. And he immediately made that request to them, and now it's out to all of us in King County, and he's going to make this request to every city in the state. So as far as where it goes next, I don't know. Like I said, the city clerk and the city attorney are all over it, and we will keep you up to date as we learn more about what the strategies are that other cities are going to follow to deal with this. What he's hoping is he gets them all electronically and he doesn't have to pay for them, or that we would waive the fees. His intent is to create this website. I think he's calling it insideyourgovernment.com. And you would be able to go to any city in the state, click on that city, and you would have access to every record that that city has. So some of the electronic ones are not going to be that difficult to do, except we have to go through a lot of them to make sure there's no attorney-client privilege things in there or any other exemptions. And then there's documents that need to be redacted that could still be released. So it's an enormous amount of work.
There was, I think it's Snohomish County, a year or so ago, there was a similar request. I don't know if it's the same person or not, but they estimated it was going to take them over a year to get the documents together, and I think two FTEs to do all that work. So over a year and a couple $100,000.
So stay tuned on that one. And then third and finally, I had reported to council a few weeks ago that a former employee of the city, Robert Ruth, was gravely ill. Well, Robert did pass away on November 28th. There is a funeral for Robert on Monday, December 7th, at St. Philomena's Catholic Church at 11 a.m. And encourage as many council members, former council members, and staff to go. Robert worked for the city for 25 years. He left a few years ago. We know his family is, sorry. So, those are my items, Your Honor. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, every year, City Council identifies, certain topics that we'd like to have, discussions about topics that we have discussions about. Earlier this year, we had one on the internet and internet access in the city of Des Moines, one that we've had for the last several years now. I think this is our fourth year doing it, is with the educational community. And in the last few years, it's actually just been higher education, but we've wanted to invite the K-12 to come present from the two school districts that represent that have children from our city. And with us tonight are Superintendent Tammy Campbell from Federal Way, Superintendent, thank you. Susan Enfield. I'm sorry. I've been sleep deprived for the last few days. So Susan Enfield from Highline School District. Lucas, I'm sorry, I forget your last name. Rux, from Central Washington University, representing the all of Central Washington University, but obviously the campus that's located at Highline, and I don't know where.
And Dr. Birmingham is at an event in downtown Seattle. I talked with Shakira yesterday. They're going to planning to leave early and try to get here by 7:20.
Okay.
So I told him, presentation-wise, we'd let him go last.
Okay. Very good. Thank you for coming tonight. We're very anxious to hear what's happening with the educational institutions in our town. Education is one of the most important things, particularly for our residents, whether it's their children or just opportunities in terms of development for themselves, in terms of work and possibility of advancement. So I think what we'll do is we'll start with K-12, and since we rarely hear from Federal Way, but had a lot of opportunity to interact with her since she was appointed back in July.
Yep.
Superintendent Campbell. So please.
First of all, I have to tell you, I'm absolutely impressed that you're holding a forum on the state of education, because I think it tells a lot about the values of the city that you put this as a priority. So good evening, Mayor Kaplan, city council members, community leaders, and others. I'm excited to share with you the work in Federal Way 5 months after I have been on the job. I will be providing with you a couple of big ideas. One is the efforts that I have been engaged in on my 100-day plan, and I will give you an update on our strategic planning process. And I've given many of you folders, and inside your folders, I just want to tell you what's there before I get into the presentation. You have an actual hard copy of my entry plan that I've included here.
If I can interrupt you for just a minute, when you go through all your material, would you prefer to have questions saved toward the end of it, or as you interactive as you go through?
You can do it authentically as I go along.
This is a pretty informal council yep. meeting. Our study sessions are so okay.
As we go, I'm totally fine with it.
Okay, great.
So you have a copy of my 100-day entry plan. You will also see a copy of the strategic plan community forum. The flyers that we're passing out to all of our community leaders. We're having forums in all five of our school board directors' districts. You will see just a handout of what I did to kick the year off with staff. So these are just some artifacts of what is happening. And so let me talk you through some of the big ideas that are in the presentation. So you can advance the slide now. Thank you. So again, the 100-day plan as well as strategic planning, and you'll see the words listen, learn, lead. That's really the theme that you'll see on my strategic plan. Some big ideas about Federal Way Public Schools. Our graduation rate, on-time graduation rate is about 77.8 or 78%. We have 39 schools, about 22,000 students, exactly 21,526. Students. We have 112 languages spoken, 2,500 staff members, and a free and reduced rate district-wide of about 58%. That's sort of the profile of our district. So the 100-day plan, in it, I actually have benchmarks around five goals that I've outlined. If you were to go to the website, you'd actually see a dashboard that's color-coded where you can actually see what I've done and how where I am in the progress. I wanted to be really transparent with the community so they could see and follow my steps as well. So up to this point, I've visited 32 schools. I've got seven more to go by December 17th. And when I say visited, I'm spending 2.5 hours at every school, walking through 10 classrooms, meeting with families, and meeting with staff. Up until this point, I've met with and talked to, and it says 300. It's probably more like 400 parents in small group forums at individual schools. I've met with every principal and central office administrator in one-on-one meetings. And I've met with now about 500 teachers in small group forums, either at their schools or across the district. I've done a lot of work. Our board of directors and I have had probably five retreats. We're really getting clear about policy governance. That's what we use in Federal Way. It's a form of governance that really clarifies the roles of the superintendent and the board. And we've revised our ends, which are really our outcomes. One of the things that I have heard right away, staff wanted to figure out ways to increase the celebrations across the system. So our board and I have established the good news announcements where we really celebrate students and staff successes at every board meeting. So that's one thing that we've done as we've gotten feedback from the staff and community. Also, as a part of my 100-day plan, I heard right away from our teachers that we needed to do a better job with curriculum, so we've started and launched an English language arts adoption, which is really reading and writing as we know it in schools. We've applied for a Deep Dive 3 grant. I'm really excited about this because as I talked to those parents, those over 400 parents, many of them said, we don't speak English and we need support in that. We want to be involved in our students' lives. And so how do we do that? So we've applied with the ESD for a grant that will allow us to train our parents who are bilingual so they can have parent academies for the other for family members, for parents who speak their language. So, for example,
kind of a trainer, train the trainer
that's right.
approach to.
So, our parents who speak Spanish and English are being trained, and then they will do 6-week academies training other parents on things like the standards, on smarter balanced assessment, on the cycle and due process related to discipline. We've asked the families what they wanted to learn about, and we've created modules based on that. I've also really focused and shared my expectations with the central office that we are here in service of students and that we have to be coherent as opposed to each person in the central office doing their own individual thing. We have to work as a system. And I really communicated the expectation that building principals are the key to school improvement. And as a result, we're ramping up the professional development for our principals because we know where our principals go will be where our schools go. So that's the 100-day plan. Again, I invite you to go to the website where you can actually track it by goal area. What I'm really excited about, and I have to thank my fellow superintendent, Dr. Enfield, because she used Performance Fact to facilitate their strategic planning process. I talked to her, and we're using the same organization. And right now, we're in the midst of it. We've had over 100 people come together on three full days so far to craft our plan. 60% of them are district, 40% are community. We have students, we have community-based organizations, and we have families on this particular 100-member team. And what I've shared with the group early on the first day, I just said, remember, this is about all of us being all in for all of our children. And we will not be able to do this alone. And this was the graphic and the quote that I had them to really think about, that it really takes a village, and we're responsible for all of our children. And as an organization, we can no longer use distancing pronouns like those kids, them, if we want to really be successful. We have to use pronouns that we would with our own children, like our, ours, you know, mine, if we really want to communicate to families how important our student scholars are. Why strategic planning in Federal Way? Well, interestingly enough, and you can continue to click it, it's going to pop up with some text for me, so I'll know what to say. We have not had strategic planning in Federal Way in 2 decades, and people are surprised by that. So
that's very surprising to hear.
Yeah, for 2 decades we haven't. And what I will tell you about Federal Way, there are so many committed educators, but what I've noticed is that we're a collection of schools versus a system of schools. And when you, if you were to say, what's our vision for each student, we don't have one collective answer. What is our mission? There's no one collective answer. What are our goals? It varies by site to site. What strategies work, and which strategies are we going to put all of our resources towards? These are the things that the strategic planning process will help us to be clear about. And more importantly, how will we measure it?
So everybody's working kind of like your own independent?
Yes. Yes, and honestly, there are a lot of districts like that that had a site-based approach where each school sort of did their, came up with their own efforts. But I'll tell you how I know that this is the right work. When I tell principals and teachers and community leaders, they're thinking, it's about time. We're glad that this is happening. So they recognize that it's that we need to have what I call a compass. And this particular strategic plan will be doing just that.
And I find it fascinating always. I was very involved. I was the Highland Council mm-hmm. PSA president, so I was in charge of all the PTAs. And then it was always interesting, Woodmont for the city of Des Moines was always kind of this outlier that your kids don't feed into our secondary schools.
Right.
But what I really found that we kind of had as an advantage in the Highline District is advantage, disadvantage is that it spreads across so many different cities, but mm-hmm. each of the cities kind of, like we'll say in the city of Des Moines, you know, our schools, our mm-hmm. 5 schools, and mm-hmm. we all know, you know, and all of our elementary schools feed into the same secondary schools.
Right.
So it really does help to contribute to the community. So I was glad to hear that you would be coming tonight to present, because I do think as a council, when we're thinking of, you know, strategies to improve education, walkabilities in our mm-hmm. downtowns, you know, safe routes to schools, mm-hmm. we often, you know, you're right, Woodmont, they are our kids also, and so
right,
yeah, and I think that you do have an interesting challenge in that sense, that just geographically the way you're laid out, you have some of those schools who have, they split into 3 different areas when they feed out of the elementary schools up into their secondary schools, and then they split again as they go off to the high school.
Right.
So
and it's even more challenging when you don't have common goals. So what one of the outcomes, and I'll share this at the end, but I'll go ahead and do it now. Once the plan is fleshed out, I would see us coming back to the city council and to this group to share what the plan is and to say, here are our goals. Now, which one do you think you can rally around? We don't have anything like that right now. And so this will be a perfect, what I call, a way for us to have a shared baton mm-hmm. that we hand and hold with our community.
That's great. Mm-hmm.
Other reasons why you want to have a strategic plan, we know that when districts do that, that there's an effect size of about 0.25, and that's a significant effect size on student achievement. So simply put, student learning goes up when you do this, as opposed to sort of bumping into each other at the central office. No one has shared goals. It's confusing. There are multiple initiatives, and people are saying, does the left hand know what the right hand is doing? Those kinds of things are not very helpful. And once we've outlined our goals, strategies, and metrics, this is a piece I was talking about. Community-based partners will gain clarity in how to support individual schools across our district. I almost would envision a process where we would say, here are the goals. What are you willing to sign up to do? And then we would have intermittent meetings with different community-based organizations to progress monitor how that support's going. The left-hand side is what we have now. We've got, so they're all heading in a direction. The problem is we're not heading in all the same direction. So this is about coherence, and that's the other reason for a strategic plan. In Federal Way, again, we have ends, and the way the governance works in this district is that the board has primarily policy work. They have given, there are ends that I'm responsible for and that I report on. These ends are things like all students graduating, all students having mastery of the grade level standards. So those ends are my responsibility. They will inform the strategic plan, but what we don't have right now, you see those arrows feeding down to those SI, the school improvement plans, that's what that stands for. And if it were really representative, there would be 39 of those representing all of our schools. So right now, there is no such thing driving that, and each of those SIPs are all over the place. This will now create coherence. And so that's really what this plan will allow for us to do as well. So whatever's in that plan, strands of that should be in the school improvement plans so that it penetrates the core all across our system. And who are we engaging in our strategic planning process? We've got students, teachers, school administrators. We've got the association, all kinds of people. I'll tell you, though, what was probably the most exciting is having students in the high schools on the committee telling us what didn't work and what did, and they are fully empowered. They have just created a reality check for that committee. They don't hold back, but they're pretty clear about what they need. And it has helped remind us why we're there. And I keep saying to the group, if it weren't for students, we would not be here. So let's keep in mind that they're the ultimate user and consumer that we should be thinking about. Here's some pictures of the group. Again, 100 strong. You'll see board members. That's the one student at the very bottom with the brown jacket. He has been so vocal about what he needs, and that's the group of them off to the right from all across the high schools, including alternative programs and kids who have not been as successful. We didn't want to just get certain types of students. We wanted a broad array so we could be thinking about that, including our board president and teachers and leaders all across the system. These are the five different groups. We've got a core planning team. That group has met 3 times already. The instructional focus team will really be our central office folks who are specializing in learning and teaching. We're going to convene 100 students in January for all day to help, again, help us to sharpen our goals. And those 5 community forums where we're providing transportation, food, and child care so that we get families who don't typically want to, who are not able to participate, who want to, but who can't because often transportation is a barrier or child care is a barrier. So again, broad-based. And here are just a few of the dates. I've already talked to you about that. City district partnerships. We have the chief of staff for the City of Federal Way on our core team, as well as the Federal Way Police Department lieutenant. So we wanted to be sure the city had an active role as a part of that. We also are looking at how we can have a focused, strategic, and coherent approach across the district, and that's where those community partnerships, that we'll convene a group of all of the community-based organizations to say, now, which goal are you going to be all in on? Okay? And as I wrap this up, this is what I really reminded the group to do, proceeding with optimism and courage, that if we were going to recreate the same system that we already had, why waste our time? That we need to really be creating something that will give us different results. So, for example, one of the things we did, and you're familiar with this process, you have 20 of, you pick 20 people in the audience, and you pick a subgroup. Say it's our African-American students, and we tell them to face the wall if these are students who are not successful right now. And the number of students, people were shocked to find only 8 students were facing out, while 12 were facing the wall, and the ones that are facing the wall have not met standard yet. So you start to really personalize that data so people can see why we need to do something different. And so I just keep reminding folks to think about students as they think about the development of the plan. You can continue to select all of these. Keep going. I've said that already. And probably the quote that I really, you'll see in my 100-day plan, this idea of let's put our minds together and see what life we can make for our children. I think implicit in that is that it's bigger than the schools. It's about what the community, the city, everybody coming together to do something pretty incredible for the students we serve.
Have you had conversation with the community and the higher education institutions, partly in South King County, but also just within the region?
Yes.
To how, whether you're soliciting any input in regards to your strategic plan on that or not? I'm just
curious.
Highline
is on, Highline Community College sits on the actual core team.
Oh, okay.
We invited two, so Lisa Scari is one of the core team members. And on our instructional core team, we've invited members from the University of Washington as well as Seattle U. So we will have higher ed input on multiple committees.
Other questions, Council?
I see you've already joined Rotary.
Yes. Yes, yes. So I'm a member of Rotary, the Chamber, and Kiwanis as well. So, yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
So in an effort to reach out to the Woodmont community at times, we've held council meetings at Woodmont.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always referred to it as Woodmont Elementary, but
it's Woodmont K to 8.
It's K-8 now. So
we call it Woodmont K to 8. So it's a K to 8 school. And
okay.
So that's how we refer to that particular site.
And does that campus have a connection with our before and after school programs or anything like
That's what I just heard, and this is a part of me still being here for 5 months, but I just talked to someone who said yes, that you do have after school programs there. So yes.
Okay, well that's great, because the intersection is interesting, because it's part of Federal Way, but mm-hmm. again the neighborhood is Des Moines, and that area is Des Moines.
What we are going to be doing at Woodmont, just so you know, as a part of our tech levy that's up for renewal in February, we're going to be doing a lighthouse tech. So our tech levy will be utilized for us to have a lighthouse tech site at Woodmont, meaning that we're going to intensify the technology that's available there. We're going to be really focusing some of our STEM activities so we have pathways out of Woodmont that articulate back up to our high schools so that we really start to do more of the career types of development for students early on. So that'll be something that I think will be pretty exciting. It'll be a site that we could bring other teachers in to see how to utilize technology in that particular context.
And then the other question I wanted to explore a little bit was, so I know you mentioned Highline College, Seattle U, and UW. Does the Highline College representation include the other colleges that are collaborating with Highline on their campus, such as Central and there's a couple others?
Not at this point. Lisa Scari is the person who's representing us, and from my understanding, no, it's just Highline.
Okay.
We reached out to several folks. It's the 3 full days. We had a very difficult time getting folks wanting to get who could give up 3 full days. So we had pretty robust outreach. The question was who could give up that much time?
And
it's actually 5 full days. We're 3 in so far.
Well, my intent was not to be critical by any means, but to point out, again, because the Highline campus creates so many post-graduation opportunities for the kids, having that well understood and well known
right
to kids that are so close by would be a good idea.
Absolutely. Makes sense.
Look especially, forward to having more conversation.
Yeah.
Especially when such a large percentage of the students at Highline are coming from Federal
Way. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. Any other questions?
No, yeah, well, first off, I really applaud you for putting together a strategic plan that's been needed for a long time, and I certainly work for an organization that lives by one, and it's really powerful if done right and followed. So thank you for doing that. Have you, in part of your visiting your sites, have you visited the Puget Sound Skills Center?
Yeah, that was
wonderful, because I know a lot of your kids go there, at least in our fire science program. So Anyway, that's great. So
yep, I was just there with Dr. Enfield. In fact, we are now scheduling a visit to take the cabinet back out to the site because, again, Federal Way has the second largest number of students who participate in the program.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Again, that's another way to build relevancy and to really capture our students. And so it's something that I definitely support, and we will be ramping up our efforts in terms of how involved we become over the next few months.
And that's good to hear, because we've had that program for well over 30 years, and it's mm-hmm. been at the Skill Center, I think, for about the last 15.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we get a lot of the students out of Federal Way, which is neat. So
absolutely.
Anyway, thank you.
And you have, I don't remember the exact, I think it's like the Harry Truman
Middle Truman Center. Mm-hmm.
Our Skill Center partners with the Truman Center.
Mm-hmm.
Such great DigiPen in the summers do these like kind of cross-pollinating programs where mm-hmm. the kids can do one series of courses in the one, and then they can go over to the Federal Way and do in the other. So,
mm-hmm.
I mean, I applaud that the two of you were, you know, I'm not sure who's coordinating all those programs, but they're just this really great seamless partnership for those kids who don't quite fit that classic mold. And then I think the K-8 with really going for a, you know, kind of a technological center, and then we've got all the secondary learning that supports that with both the Truman Center and the Skill Center and, you know, the Running Start programs that we have at Highline. So that's fantastic. It's great.
Yeah, you know, and you know, Dr. Enfield has been at this a little bit longer than myself, but I will tell you what I do know is that philosophically our beliefs around continuous improvement and how do you improve a system, I would say we're sisters in that. Mm-hmm. And very similar approaches to how we're going about the work, which helps for collaboration across the system. And so she's been a great in reaching out to me in my first few months here, and I know that we're only going to strengthen the partnership, which only helps to support what's happening in this city as well as in Federal Way.
Great.
Other questions? Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.
Superintendent Enfield.
So thank you, council members, for having me tonight. And I just want to say that Dr. Campbell and I have known each other from a distance for some time, but we have gotten to know each other very well over the past few months. And it might not be readily apparent, but I do believe we are related. And so we really do, I think, have a sort of a kindred connection around this work, and we're really lucky to have her in the region. So I just needed to say that publicly. So I am going to share with you some of the information that I shared in my State of the Schools address, which we did just a few weeks ago, and that we do annually, and then talk a little bit about what's on the horizon, and I'm sure you'll have some questions and comments to make on that as well. And so I will just get going. Microphone. That's not going to advance the slides, is it? I'm just so used to having something I can touch and make it do something, right? Thank you. So we won't bury the lead. We'll start with what we're really pleased about. So as you know, we are in year three of our four-year strategic plan, which I think at this point you've all committed to memory, I'm sure, because we talk about it constantly. But and as you know, we're aiming for a 95% graduation rate at a minimum. And as you see, we've been in the low 60s for quite a while, and for the first time this year, we got above 70%. And I have to say, it's tough because you want to celebrate that, because going from 62.9 to 70.3 is not nothing, but it's still so far from where we need to go. It still means that 3 out of 10 kids aren't getting across that stage. So that said, it is a significant accomplishment, and I have to say that what also makes it significant isn't just that more students are graduating successfully, but I will say I have pushed staff very hard in the 3.5 years since I've been in Highline, and we needed to push ourselves on behalf of our children. And I think this jump is sort of a shot in the arm for the hard work that staff is doing and that they realize it's paying off. And so symbolically, I think it's as important as it is materially for our kids' futures. I will say I had actually a conversation with Brad Tilden from Alaska Airlines recently, and he was challenging me a little bit on the 95% rate goal, and he said, you know, that's a really, I don't know if I could set a goal like, you know, what are you doing? It's pretty aspirational. And I said, well, you know, I understand it's somewhat aspirational, but we set that with great intention, and I did it. I didn't do it. I mean, I put it out there, but our community and staff came up with it in our strategic plan, but it was important for two reasons. Number one, when I arrived 3.5 years ago, there just seemed to be an acceptance that this was as good as we could do. There was no sense of disgust, outrage, anything over a 62% graduation rate, and I didn't get it. And I also sort of had come to this realization that in this era of No Child Left Behind, we had become accustomed to setting more achievable targets for ourselves. And in doing so, we're communicating to our children that we were writing some of them off. Kids are smart. When they see that you're setting a goal of 70%, they know that 3 out of 10 of them aren't going to make it, that you've given up on them. And they don't know which ones. But that's the message we're sending, and I refuse to send that message. By the same token, people, I got criticism, why not 100%? Well, the reality is that there will always be some outlier, and if we say 100%, people write it off as a platitude. Ah, they're just putting one of those pie-in-the-sky goals out there, they're never going to get there. 95% people have to pay attention to. And what I'm proud to say is that we're all starting to pay attention. And this is the result of the hard work of our kids, our teachers, our principals, our staff, and our families in getting them there. And I think what it has also done is it has really just shined a light on this issue. And I can't go into any principal's office anywhere in this district and not see on their board by year the number of students who are 0.5 credits behind, 1 credit behind, 2 or more credits behind, and a database with the interventions that they're applying. So this is really front and center for folks right now, student by student, which is where it needed to be. So this is the result of a lot of hard work, but hard work is amorphous sort of thing. So I want to talk a little bit about some of the specific strategies that I believe are leading us towards this trajectory of higher graduation rates. And you're also welcome to interrupt as we go.
Well, I'm glad you're doing that because to say it was a combination of hard work.
Right.
Hard labor, what does that
mean? And what hard work, right? Yeah, yeah.
So you're going to get more specific?
I am. Sure. Next slide. Okay, so as you know, part of our strategic plan is to eliminate out-of-school suspensions except when critical for staff and student safety. This was because when I arrived, we were suspending students and expelling them by the thousands. And the reality is that the kids tell us it doesn't work. And we were suspending them mostly for defiance. Now, I will tell you, we will always continue. As you can see, we're not at zero. Right? And we'll never be at zero, but because there's always going to be student and staff safety concerns. I was at Pacific Middle School, actually, yesterday, talking with Diana Garcia. When I walked in, she was meeting with a young man who is her student of the moment, and he's having a tough time. Some potential gang grooming and affiliation, really acting out in class, especially in math, screaming at the teacher, et cetera, et cetera. And they've done everything. He now does math in the principal's office, et cetera, et cetera. And they've done so much to work with him. But she did out of school suspend him for 3 days last week, as she should have. So I just want to sit here and tell you, nobody is saying we will not out of school suspend. But we have now set an expectation, a culture, where it really has to be justifiable. Right, and it's not going to be because you annoyed me.
So
exactly, there you go, there you go. So and also, I will say, being now in my fourth year, 75% of our principals are either my hire or my placement. So I have great trust and confidence in my principals. So when my principal says to me, "I out of school suspended that kid," I don't question that, because I know that that person has done all the intervention they need to, and that it was justified in the moment. That said, this is still very much a work in progress. I will tell you, though, Pacific Middle School is leading the way. All this year, that was the only out-of-school suspension they have had.
Wow.
That one.
From Pacific. That says a lot, actually.
It's what?
That says a lot. About
And let me tell you, it's because of leadership, it's culture, but it's also because of a man named Matt Berman, who is our re-engagement specialist. So I ask a lot of the adults in the system, including myself, but I don't ask a lot without giving something in return. I'm not asking people to reach these goals just by sheer will. You have to resource it. So every middle and high school has a full-time re-engagement specialist who runs the in-school suspension and then also pushes out into the classes so that we're building the relationships with the students, getting them the counseling, getting them back on track. It's great. And he is wonderful. And so that's what's happening there. So this is real. And I'm, you know, this is still, some people are still critical of this because there's some misperceptions that the learning environment is compromised, et cetera, et cetera. A study, however, just came out. The Seattle Times did a story in it, and if you like, I can send you the link tomorrow. A study out of UCLA showing that when suspensions go down, actually student achievement goes up.
Well, and I have a son who's at Mount Rainier, and he has said that, and he came up through Pacific, and he said the peer pressure then, the kids are getting annoyed because they're like, dude, knock it off, we're trying to learn. And so instead of before it became remove the problem, take them out of the class, now it really becomes more socially inappropriate to act out in class because the kids are all aware of the fact this turkey's going to still stay in class or he's going to come back tomorrow, and we're just, so it really does become this positive reinforcement within the peer groups that they're like, it's not cool to act out in class anymore.
And so, positive peer pressure.
Right, and so I think that it's, you know, you're finding now it's becoming culturally, the kids are culturally aware of the fact that that's not okay to act that way in class anymore.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I want to be clear that, we, you know, obviously we take safety as paramount, but also respect for other students, for teachers. We're not going to tolerate that. But the first recourse is not to boot you out of school for 5 days, right? It's to sit you down and find out what's going on and figure that out. So we are very, very proud of this work. It is hard work. At its heart, it is a culture shift. It is a culture shift in the way adults relate to students. That's really what discipline comes down to. And that really rests on mutual respect. And so that's what we're really working on, is helping our teachers, not just with, like, you know, I can teach de-escalation techniques, but as a teacher, an adult in a school, you have to communicate to those children that you respect them and you care about them and you will help them succeed. And students can sense that or not. And when it's not there, that's when we have problems. So we're really focusing on those adult-student connections. And I'm also proud to say that the state will be releasing a significant amount of discipline data statewide tomorrow. And in the roadmap region, the 7 districts within the roadmap, with the exception of Tukwila, which is small, Highline has far and away the lowest suspension rates of any of the other districts in South King County.
I was just going to ask, does your presentation include information regarding the roadmap piece?
It doesn't. You, the comparison around discipline specifically or in general?
In general.
It doesn't, but I can speak to anything around the roadmap that you'd like me to.
When you get to the
end. Okay, okay. So anyway, so this is, so I believe that actually keeping kids in school helps with the graduation rate. I'm funny that way. I think there's a connect there that if we're not pushing them out, we're actually keeping them in. And by the way, not just keeping them in, but keeping them in with those positive relationships and interventions. But positive relationships, respect, and interventions aren't enough. They need to be challenged, pushed, and educated well. So we've also looked at making sure that every student has access to rigorous high school courses. So this year, every single high school campus, so that is Mount Rainier, Highline, Evergreen, Tyee, has what we're calling academic assurances, a set level of advanced courses, AP, advanced science, that every student knows they're going to have access to. Because if we're going to assign students to high schools, which we do for the most part, parents and students have to know that they are going to have equal access to certain things. And quite frankly, we were denying students, mostly at Tyee and Evergreen, access to advanced placement courses. And I think it's unconscionable to assign children to a school, and especially children who may not have people who can advocate for them. You know as well as I do, none of you would tolerate for a minute your child being assigned to a school where they didn't have access to advanced placement. You wouldn't. And as the superintendent, I won't tolerate it for any of our kids.
So Dr. Enfield, how do you do that in a small schools model? Because you have two different models throughout your district. You have a conventional,
yes,
conventional high schools and academies.
Great question. Well, and to be honest, I want to say that I think that's why there was such a challenge in the number of AP courses, because when you have those autonomous small schools, it is very difficult, which I think is one of the drawbacks to the autonomous small schools. There are advantages in terms of relationship building and culture, but this access to rigorous coursework is just too important. So what I've pushed since my arrival is the need for some cross-crediting and enrollment. So not each of the schools has to offer all the same AP, but if you look at all the schools, you know, if I'm over here, I could actually go take the AP computer science class over here if I wanted to. So really pushing our schools to as many as possible offer on their own, but then do some cross enrollment, which, you know, is new, and that it rocks people's world a little bit, but that's all right. And, you know, and we're seeing, and we have seen, and I think it'll be on the next slide, you know, if you offer it, they will come. And, you know, I think there's the sense that students don't want to really take the hard courses or be challenged. I think sometimes students don't know what they're capable of. So it's all about, are we giving them access, and are we giving them the encouragement and support to be successful once they've accessed that coursework? So, yeah, it's been a challenge, but we have made sure that every single, I mean, we were in a situation where, in some instances, physics wasn't being offered. It's a problem. So now what we're saying is chemistry and physics everywhere. You know, world language everywhere, pre-calc and calculus everywhere, and at least one AP course in junior and senior year in core content areas, in language arts, social studies, math, et cetera.
And I think you bring up a great point about the support, because a rigorous course is maybe not necessarily the direction every child wants to go.
Right.
And, you know, I've got a friend whose son came up for the highly capable program at Parkside, and for all intents and purposes, we thought, man, TC is heading off to Stanford. This kid is brilliant. I mean, he's got one of those men's IQs, and got through rigorous coursework, and he got to about his junior year of high school, and he said to his mom, I just want to be a kid.
Yeah.
It's my senior year. I just want to be a mm-hmm. kid. So he kind of just decided, you know, he wanted to take a year mm-hmm. and not have it be so hard. Sure. And I think that had there not been an option of, here's your rigorous course, but then there's also your standard coursework. And now he is actually a union pipe fitter, and he's like, I am so happy.
Happy as a clam.
That this is the course I chose to take. And he often says, had he really been forced to stick with, you know, you're going to get your IB diploma, and you're going to do this, and you're going to do that. He's like, I would have dropped out of college and been miserable. And so I think it is important that we do, I think that both of our districts that appear to be doing, is that we do identify and we have that support there for that child. Absolutely. Who just either doesn't want to. Sure, they're capable of it, but they've made a conscious decision
right.
with the support of their family that, or they just truly can't.
And you know, and I did pretty well in AP English. I probably would have been abysmal in AP Calculus. No. So, I mean, everybody could have told me until the cows came home that I should take that class, and there was no way I would have taken that class. The one thing that I just, and I apologize, I always make this omission. There is no AP at Mount Rainier because it's an IB school. So we have International Baccalaureate at Mount Rainier. I always forget to make that distinction. So, do you have a question?
No, I just, I think most children overall want to be challenged at some point, and that's why they go one way or the other. If they're not offered the ability to be challenged, they'll choose challenge somewhere else. And if they don't have that opportunity, we could lose them.
And I think, too, each of us around this table and in this room can think about a time in our life where somebody believed in us and encouraged us to do something that we didn't know we were capable of. And had we not gotten that encouragement, we never would have tried to do that and been successful. And that's what we have to do for our kids. So, next slide. So this is, you can see the increase in enrollment in AP, and it's significant. So we've increased the number of students enrolled in AP by 50% since I arrived.
What percentage of the students is that? I'm out of curiosity.
Oh, boy. So that's a good question. Of all of our high school students, I don't know, but I can get you that percentage. I'll get it for you.
10%? I mean,
Maybe between 10 and 15. It could still be higher.
That's still amazing.
It's look at where we were. You know, we've gone from, you know, a little over 600 to getting close to 1,000 kids who are enrolled in AP. Now, I will tell you, too, we now want to make sure that their passage rates are good. Though I will also say this, that we know, and there's data to show from the College Board, that benefits to students for having just taken the AP course and the AP exam, even if they don't do as well as they had hoped. That discipline, managing that amount of work, I mean, it's, you know, part of what AP is, it's like a giant inbox exercise, right? You're going to get all this stuff and you've got to figure out, you know, how are you going to navigate through it and do it successfully. So, I mean, that's the skill that kids need wherever they're going to go after they graduate high school. So I believe that setting a higher expectation, a higher bar for our kids, giving them the access to these challenging courses, and making sure that, and by the way, there are no gatekeepers in these courses. You don't need a recommendation to take an advanced placement course. You don't need to take a test. Any student who says, I'm up for the challenge, I'm in, is in. So I just want to be clear on that. And I will say, we it's changed a little bit this year, but overall, our advanced placement course enrollment is fairly close to our overall district demographics, which is quite unique. What you see, as you would guess, in many places of significant diversity is you don't see that diversity in the advanced placement classes. And we actually do see that here, which is also a very, very good thing. So we're keeping kids in school by changing our discipline policy and culture. We're making sure students have access to really rigorous coursework. Yeah.
I'd be curious to hear from the secondary establishments about reputation building of school districts. And if you have an applicant fill out that they're from Bellevue School District or the Lake Washington School District, you tend to know that they have a rigorous standard of excellence. And so I applaud kind of what you're doing. When I was applying to colleges, say, oh, I went to Bethel, and they'd go, sorry. But come on. He laughs because his wife went there, too. So I mean, I think, have you found that as the, you know, and I'm thinking of, you know, class of 13, 14, 15,
sure.
As these kids are applying to universities, have you seen or have we even started to collect data on?
Not quite yet, but it's a really good point, and we are going to start doing that. I had, and this sort of previews a topic that I'll bring up at the end around next steps in the future of the district, et cetera, but I had a really sort of heartbreaking moment today at Highline High School with a group of seniors, juniors and seniors, who wanted to talk about some of the concerns they have about their building, as do I, and, you know, the fact that we can't replace it yet, you know, without the bond. But they had other concerns as well around the kind of support they had, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, one girl said, you know, we know that our reputation isn't really good and that people, you know, I hate this term and I'm only going to use it because it's the ghetto school, you know, that people know that we're from Highline, that we're not, you know, that good. And the overall tone in the room was, and it was spirit days, they're all, you know, purple and yellow all over the place, and it was just defeated. They were just defeated. And we have to do something about that, you know, because they are special and they are deserving and capable. And it's our job as the community to make sure that they have what they need and are deserving of. Clearly, at some point, that's going to be a new school building. And I think what really came, because I don't believe that a beautiful facility makes for a great education, so I want to be clear on that, but I guess it just really hit home to me today, talking to the kids, how significant getting that school rebuilt is. It's just really, really significant. But I share that because, yes, reputation matters, and the kids know. I believe that sort of in the adult world, I think people are starting to see the work that's happening and that we are moving in the right direction, but we're not there yet. You know, but... you know, my contract goes through 2018 at this point. They can extend it if they want another year. You know, I intend to stick around until we get this done and until we are the district that people look to as one, as a point of pride in the region, because we can and we will. Well.
We're talking a couple of years here with these games that are being discussed.
Yeah. Sure. Another 3 or 4 years, and I believe we're going to have a great story to tell. But it's going to take another 3 or 4 years. You know, we've started to turn the corner, but we haven't turned the corner. But yes, we are on that trajectory, and there is momentum. There is real momentum. Did somebody have a question? I'm sorry.
I was going to wait to the end, but you know, it seems like after elementary school, parent involvement kind of dies off, and I can see through some of the people that I know that even parent involvement in middle school. And up in, those kids are still kids. Mm-hmm. I mean, they are. And they seek approval from adults. What is the plan to get more PTA and parent involvement in the middle school and the high school arena? Because those kids still look for, as you were saying, improvement and validity from adults. And if they're defeated and they have a core group of adults behind them and parents behind them, then that changes the game. I see it on a daily basis. I see it, ESL students that at the beginning of the year were not even reading at a third grade level and are now, from one parent's involvement, half an hour a week, reading with them are up to a third grade level. And that can transfer into high school and middle school, and there's virtually no involvement.
Yeah. So I think we've got some good news on that front, too. So obviously, you know, we have four pillars in our strategic plan, and one of them is strong partnerships with families and community. And you are right that it gets harder. And the irony is that actually the kids need us more the older they get. you know, at middle school it starts to taper off, and high school sort of drops off, unfortunately. We have seen some extraordinary turnout this year of families at school events, and in surprise, under surprising circumstances. So Karen Jones, who's the principal at Chinook, they're looking at evolving towards standards-based grading. So where rather than, you know, you got an A or you got an F and it's over, you're actually working towards a standard. And when you meet that standard, you move on. And it's a shift in grading, but it's kind of becoming the thing. It makes a lot of sense. They did an information night on standards-based grading, and they had over 200 families come. So I wouldn't go to an information night on standards-based grading after a long day of work. But, I mean, so we're doing a better job of communicating out what's going on and bringing people in. And I have to say, I think a big part of that is we have had some turnover in staff. And now I think as new teachers, paraprofessionals, principals, whomever come into the district, they want to be here. They're coming in because they believe in what Highline is doing, and so they come in with that right mindset. They know parents are partners. It's still a work in progress. I don't want to say that we've got it figured out, but it's very much something that we are talking about, and I think it really is our schools welcoming places. A lot of times our parents just don't feel welcome. You know, we did customer service training for the second year in a row this year with all of our front office staff. And I said, you know, I walk in sometimes and I don't feel welcome. My name's on the bottom of your check. What?
You get the Highline app
on your iPhone. Yeah, you can go. You're not going to offend me. It's okay. Bye-bye. Friends don't make friends sit through their presentations after talking about it. So thank you, Dr. Campbell.
Thank you, yes.
Tammy?
Well, actually...
For me or her?
No, it's actually for both of you.
Oh, okay.
So going forward, you're both making a lot of progress, and we haven't seen the full extent from Highline's presentation yet. But is there a connection, because your Running Start children will go to most likely the Highline campus, although, and is there any way that you're measuring how your success carries forward into, you know, higher ed?
The success.
Yeah. And you may not be there to collect that yet, but is that part of the plan? Is there dialogue happening now?
Sure. We see those results, and this switch in terms of looking at ways to articulate English and math in particular, working with the school districts as opposed to this crazy testing that everybody has done in the past, placement testing. But working between faculty with Federal Way and faculty with Highline School District on how areas articulate with our curriculum so they know where College Ready is, or they know where, you know, the first course before College Ready is. And being able to do that and have faculty have had those conversations, yeah, we work on that very closely, and it's been a huge project, huge progress in placement. So, yeah, there's close cooperation on that, and that speaks larger than what their grade is, because that's, you know, we know to trust the assessment, because that puts them in an area where they're going to be successful, and looking at their success, since we've used that for placement, has significantly increased the student's success.
One of my next goals, though, is to start looking at completion rates once our students leave. So 2-year completion, 4-year completion. And we're not doing a good job of tracking that. And that's a huge goal of mine, because as part of my kickoff this year, I interviewed one of our, Samoan young man whom I met when I was interviewing for the job as superintendent here. And it was he and his friends whose class I did as part of my interview, and asked them what the superintendent needed to know. And, you know, they kind of hooked me. So after I was offered the job and accepted, I went back to this class and to thank them for, I said, look, you guys convinced me to take this job. And these two boys who were going off to Central Washington University, they were seniors, and I said, you know, well, look, they had done a really fabulous senior project on ensuring Samoan student success, on how school districts can do a better job of helping our Samoan youth. And I said, look, when you come back from Central, you email me. I gave them my card. I said, I'll take you to, you know, lunch or breakfast. I just want to hear, what's your experience at college? How are you ready? How are you not? And their first thing was, well, you know, we eat a lot. I said, well, so do I. So that's that. Yeah, bring it. That's fine. And sure enough, you know, a few months later, they you know, they came and I took them out to lunch and they talked a little bit. But not long after that, they really struggled and ended up losing their scholarship money because they, you know, we hadn't prepared them. And it wasn't just that we hadn't prepared them academically. We hadn't prepared them to go from White Center to Central to Ellensburg, Washington. That's a very that's a culture shift of epic proportion, and well, let me tell you what one of these young men said to me. He said it felt like everybody else knew the secret and we didn't. You know. Together, yeah.
Well, when I was on the board, the Highline School Board, we spent a lot of time talking about the value of that diploma, because I know Dr. Birmingham and I at one point years ago talked about, you know, one of the challenges of kids as they move forward into their freshman year of college is they may have a diploma, but are they ready? And there was work, I know that you had mentioned, that had to be done. Sometimes you had, it was a less than 100 level math or English class. And I assume that Central has the same. Over here, you tend to pick up students in the final 2 years. But in Ellensburg, you get all four. And so, you know, again, that's another thing that I think as, you know, we look forward, that's the kind of data connection that I think will truly show success.
I agree. So I refer to our diploma as a ticket to the future of a student's choice, which means it has to get you somewhere. It's not just a piece of paper. So I will, just before I move on to this next slide, and I'm sorry, I know that you have other business, but sort of to circle back to Glendall, the student I talked to you about, after leaving, being asked to leave Central, this has a happy ending, he came back. And with the help of one of his former teachers, who wasn't just going to let him sit home on the couch, she said, you're going to get a job and you're going to go to South Seattle College and you're going to get back on track. And he worked to save enough money to pay for his next quarter back at Central. And he went back, and he's back this year. And he is he's in his fourth year, but with junior status because of his lost time, and he's got a 4.0. And he also, for the second year in a row, hosted the Uprise Conference at Highline College, which is a conference for Pacific Islander students, families, and educators on what they can do to help them be successful in college and beyond. He's an outstanding young man. So, it's again, that's sort of anecdotal data, but I completely agree with you that it needs to be a meaningful diploma that guarantees. I always say a diploma should be a guarantee to the student, the community, the college, that student's prepared, right? That's what it has to be. And I believe that access to these more rigorous courses will help get us there. Because if you're getting low-level courses, that diploma won't mean anything. So I've talked about the discipline. I've talked about access to rigorous courses, but we also need to talk about relevance, right, and interest. So computer science is huge. What kid isn't into computers right now? So we were an early partner with code.org. I'm not sure that you've heard of them, but next week is the Hour of Code. Be a great time to be in schools because all the kids are going to be coding. It's super exciting, and it's a Star Wars theme this year, so they're all going to be into it. So we made the decision the year before last to offer exploring computer science with partnering at code.org across all of our four high school campuses. Across Washington State, roughly 10% of high schools offer computer science.
Oh my gosh.
Uh-huh. Living in the shadow of Microsoft Amazon, everyone, roughly 10% of high schools offer computer science. Now, I'm guessing that number may have gone up in the last year or two because of Code.org's interest, but we offer it across all of our main high school campuses. Every kid has access to it. And we've seen the number of kids enrolling growing. And what I'm really excited about is that the College Board has a brand new Advanced Placement Computer Science Principles course, and it is being piloted this year at the ACE campus on Taiyi. It's a very, very rigorous course. Kids have, and so that's what I, you know, when I said we're going to offer computer science, I mean, I had people say, they're not going to sign up. I'm like, let's try. What do we got to lose? And, you know, I pulled the boss card. I'm like, thou shalt. You know, sometimes, you know, you just have to say, you're going to do this, and here's why. And the kids, and more sign up every year. And the kids are loving it. They're into it. And I will tell you, this is the coolest thing. At Highline High School, there's a group of girls that got so psyched by their class last year that they wanted to start this after-school apps coding club for girls. And it got so good that the boys wanted to join. And, of course, they let them. And, of course, we have to through Title IX. But I love the fact that we are now in a culture where the girls are starting clubs that they're allowing the boys into. I think that's progress in some kind of way. So so we're very, very proud of the work that's happening. And the kids are loving this. And so this relevance piece is huge. And that's what's going to take me to the next slide, which is I want to be really clear. I want every child from Highline to graduate with a diploma that guarantees they are college ready. But they may not necessarily be college-bound at that moment. So what are we doing to make sure that our students see their high school education as relevant to a career path that may not require a four-year degree, but does require a high level of skill? So we made a significant investment a year and a half ago in working to see that as many students as possible have some work-based learning experience before they graduate. And you can see that since fall of 14, we've had almost 900 kids in internships, which is huge. We have kids going on career exploration trips, job shadows, and this was, I got some external grant funding to sort of seed this work, and now it's up and running. And this is all, you know, this is not all about the Skills Center. This is work that we are doing as a system. And what we're seeing is, and in the roadmap region, Highline has the highest percentage of students enrolled in CTE. So we know that this is a high interest area for our kids. And so what we're trying to do is make sure that we're providing them with a what I call a window into the world of work so that they can see how what they're learning is going to take them somewhere else. And so what we have done a horrible job in K-12 education is exposing kids to all the pathways that are available to them, right? And validating each of those pathways as equally worthy. So what we've said this year is we want to borrow what our friends in Spokane did, and it's an initiative they call T24, technical two-year, four-year. You know, and so we want to make sure that the technical path that a student chooses to go to after high school is just as celebrated as the kid who gets the four-year ride to UW or what have you. So as some of you may know, Ray Connor, who's the CEO of Boeing Commercial Airplanes, is an alum of Highline High School. And he did an interview last year in the paper about how they need a pipeline of kids. I got on the phone with him later. I said, your pipeline starts here. And so he sent last spring a bunch of managers from Boeing to come and interview kids at the Skills Center. And a couple dozen kids are working full-time now at Boeing. And they're making, you know, $35,000. I mean, so it's a living wage. And after 1 year at Boeing, Boeing will give them $17,500 a year for their education. That's a game changer for a kid, right? So I'm very, very deliberate in saying I want every kid college ready, but their path and what they choose to do is their own. So we are making sure that we're celebrating the kids who choose that, as well as we're celebrating the kids who go to four-year, because it's not all about four-year, right? It's about two-year, it's all of it. And we really want to increase our two-year enrollment, our four-year enrollment, but we also want to increase our kids' exposure to the incredible, there's so many jobs in this region that require some kind of technical certificate or but not a four-year degree. And we've got to get real about promoting that and celebrating that in a way that we haven't. And, you know, here's the anecdote I give. At the State of the Schools, Ray Connor interviewed Keone, a young woman who graduated from Puget Sound Skills Center last year and who's working at Boeing full-time now. And I don't remember exactly what she does, but Tony and I had this conversation where she seals something on the airplane. Well, I don't know about you. I want everything on the airplane I'm on, 30,000 feet in the air, to be sealed well, right? So you want to know why you invest in K-12 education, why everyone here and everyone everywhere should care? It's because those kids are going out and they're building your airplanes. They're going to educate your children. They're going to take your temperature. They're going to draw your blood, all of that. So, you know, we really need to celebrate that and say to people, you know, what we do now matters, because those kids are going out into the workplace with really seriously responsible jobs. Okay, now I got to wrap it up. So, okay, look, we are Highline. There we go. So I would say it's really changing the culture around discipline. It's rigorous coursework, but it's the relevance and connection to career. And I would say that we're on the right track. We have miles to go, but I am incredibly, incredibly proud of the work that's happening. And you can go to, there was one more slide that talked about the things that I wanted to sort of say to you. So number one, I know that you'll ask about bond. And the board will make a decision, I would guess, sometime this summer about exactly when to put the bond on the ballot again. It's not an if, it's a when, but we want to be smart about that. And we have a wonderful man named Chuck Tooman from Highline Citizens, who's now going to run Highline Citizens for Schools, because we need a robust citizens group. We really didn't have it last time, and we need it this time around. And so I'm open to ideas of how we do that, because if you had been in that room with these kids today, you simply wouldn't be able to sleep tonight knowing that we had let them down this way. So obviously we'll be coming back as we get ready for that. Our enrollment is continuing to grow, so the need isn't going away. We didn't grow as much as we had thought we would this year, which is a good thing. It's a little breathing room because we're sort of maxed out. But we're projected to be at over 20,000 students this time next year. So the growth is going to continue. One of the greatest needs that I hear from families, parents, schools is the need for more after-school care, after-school opportunities, wraparound services. And so at our quarterly city manager's breakfast the other day, one of the things on my to-do list is to figure out how maybe we can partner with the cities to create certain hub sites at some of our schools. So the school becomes a hub in the community. It's open maybe two nights a week until 8 o'clock on Saturdays, where families, kids can come, use the gym, use the library for the computers. I mean, they're just sitting there. And so if we can somehow partner on resources, time, people, I think that would be a powerful, powerful thing to do, especially in some of our schools where there isn't a lot around there or a lot going on. So I would say that moving forward, those are going to be the two big areas that I would love to partner with our city friends with. And we will probably a year from now be, hard to believe, starting on version 2.0 of our strategic plan. And we'll obviously look for your, participation and guidance in that as well. So I'll just end with the quote that I used earlier this year with my staff, which is a Teddy Roosevelt quote. He had great quotes. And he says, far and away, the greatest prize life has to offer is the chance to work hard at work worth doing. I don't know any work more worth doing than the work we're doing in Highline. And so I just really thank you. We feel your support all the time, and we're grateful for it, and thanks for letting me be here tonight. And because I know you're all jealous because you probably saw me wearing my We Are Highline pin, I have one for each of you. So just
to you as well. I have a question. One of the, you know, a lot of the discussion that you had talked about is college ready. And yet there are those students that may not have the capability for that, but have knowledge and skill set and abilities that would fulfill a need that is sorely lacking, particularly within the construction trades and the others. That section of the economy, the construction trade, there's a lot of men and women in the trades now who are close to retirement, and there are not a lot of people coming up behind them, and the need is there.
Absolutely.
It's huge. And it's the balancing act between not wanting to tamp down somebody's expectation, but at the same time provide an opportunity for a good paying job and something that the entire community needs. Mm-hmm. And we're going to begin seeing it as competition for bids come out. When companies don't have the employees to be able to build.
Well, that's what our skills center does beautifully well. And I'm sorry if I didn't go sort of deep enough into that, but sort of when I say T24, when I say technical, that isn't necessarily technical college. That is just a technical path where maybe you're doing an apprenticeship or something. But I agree with you. I mean, we have kids right now who are in our construction program. You know, we have a welding program, marine science, machinists, composites. That's a big thing right now, especially in the area where we are. So we are very much... and we also, I made some changes to the leadership of our CTE. So Thomas Mosby, who was overseeing the Skills Center last year. I actually sort of asked him to oversee not just the Skills Center, so there's somebody else running the Skills Center. Todd right now is running the Skills Center, but also our CTE programs across all of our high schools. And I talked to you about the work that Julie Burr is doing on career awareness, you know, the internship piece, and Thomas is overseeing all of that. So he's working on making sure that we're expanding as quickly as we can the number of opportunities for kids like that. I think where I said we've done an abysmal job is communicating what all those opportunities are for kids. They just don't know. Exactly. Big Picture does a great job of it. Yeah. Yeah.
To speak of Dave's point is to educating the parents that the trades field is no longer a prison, an ex-con, a druggie field. Having a father that was in the trades that never wanted his five boys to go into the trades, and I'm the only one out of them that's in the trades, I do pretty well for myself. And it's you have to have some sort of skill to be in the trades now.
Yeah, it's not a low level, it's very high level skill, and that's what we have to be talking about. I agree.
Absolutely.
The other thing is that as the economy changes here in Des Moines, as some businesses come in, for example, today, Green Core, a company that packages food and has an innovation center that they're going to be building in our business park, is going to be hiring somewhere between 400 and 500 people. And one of the things that they brought up today that, I'm sending them your way, by the way, but is being able to recruit people to come in. And some things require certain skill sets, and other things require of varying levels.
Sure.
And so there's opportunities there, and we want to make sure that everybody in our community knows about it and has that opportunity. So one of the conversations we had today was trying to find ways to partner with them so that we're better able to share what employment opportunities exist in the community with the development that's going on, so that people here are able to avail themselves of those good jobs. And to the degree that it's a foot in the door to a future with the company, developing their educational skill set or other technical skills that they need in order to be able to advance with them. Mm-hmm. So as our business park builds out, as the hotel opens up, as other things happen in town, there's going to be opportunities for students at all levels. And
we may need to look then, too, at are there other areas of career focus that the Skills Center may need to explore offering to meet those new needs? Because, you know, I'm a big believer that we want to work on our economy thriving. What is our local economy demanding so that our kids don't have to go far, right, to make a living wage, and also for our economy to thrive? I mean, that's why we're all caring about education. So I would love to have that conversation whenever you like.
Tony?
Yeah, one thing that I'd like to ask you about is the move to changing start times for schools, particularly high schools.
Oh, yeah.
But even the middle schools and grade schools, there's talk of moving that around, because that's going to impact how we provide our before and after school programs in a couple of ways. One, the elementary schools and the middle schools, we're providing the programs here, but it's the high school kids that are coming in, and in some cases are the frontline employees who are providing those programs. So are you guys looking at that?
Yeah, so you've probably seen it's all the rage, because Seattle, if Seattle's doing it, it has to be good. So you know, Seattle made the bold move to, and it's you know, and the research is so clear, right? I mean, in an ideal world, our little ones would be coming to school earlier, because all of you probably know that, you know, the 7-year-olds are bouncing off the wall by 7 a.m. And the teenagers could use a little more sleep. Obviously, there are some very practical issues around the amount of daylight that exists and how early you want to let 5-year-olds stand alone in the dark, which I offer not at all, and the fact that we have a limited bus fleet. You know, we don't have unlimited buses that we can put on the road, so we stagger our, and you know this, we stagger it based on the buses we have. The board has asked staff to put together an analysis, a proposal of how we could allow high school students to start later. It would not change at this point our elementary or middle schools, and the analysis we've done to date would add an extra half hour to high school start times. I mean, I'm sorry, wouldn't add an extra half hour. It would start later. Kids are freaking out. Another half hour of school. They would start a half hour later. So I don't know but this has not been decided on. It's not happening. We've just been asked to explore it, given that other districts in the region are looking at this. We need to know what our families think about it to make sure that this is something that they want. The board wants to know how the community feels. So more to come on this in the months ahead, I would imagine. Mm-hmm.
The only thing I want to bring up, there are some developments that are being proposed here in Des Moines that are going to impact some of the mobile home parks that we have. And we're currently in the process of trying to identify how many of those families have kids in the Highline District and see if we can partner with CMAR and with King County Housing Authority to see if we can help provide some direction to help keep the kids in the district.
Right.
But I wanted you to be aware of that.
Would the Rapid Rehousing Program help with that? So we have a partnership with King County Housing, it's called Rapid Rehousing, and it's a national model, and we have it in all of our elementary schools. And what they do is they provide assistance to families in transition so that the kids can stay, if the family's in flux housing-wise, the kids can stay in their school. They give them temporary housing while they look for permanent housing rather than... Yeah, yeah. It's been really powerfully successful in the region. So if you like, I know Steve Norman would be happy to have that conversation, but it's called Rapid Rehousing, and we've seen great success with it. And I just want to say, you know, our mobility rate and the reason why what Tammy does matters so much to me as a Federal Way kid yesterday is a Highline kid tomorrow. And our mobility rate, meaning the amount that kids is about 20-25% any given year. So, you know, it matters. Please let me know, Dave, how I can help with that, because there could be maybe a solution.
Representative Orwell and I are been okay, in conversation good. On this topic, and so we're looking to
great.
To see what we can do. But I hadn't heard of the Rapid Rehousing Program, so thank you for mm-hmm. that.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Sorry, I know I went a little long.
Okay. Any other questions?
Well, like I've always said to you over the years, there's something about your enthusiasm is contagious.
It's not wearing off, is it?
That's a good sign, by
That's
the way.
That's a good sign. Well, we are Highline, and I hope you wear your pins with pride. So,
thank you.
And happy holidays.
Thank you.
Can I give him a hug?
I know you got here early, but Dr. Birmingham sounds like he's got a cold or a little tired. I'm not sure which. If you don't mind my deferring.
Not at all. Not at all. Please.
Jack.
Hi. So I think we've got something that'll come up here in a minute. Right, so tonight I just wanted to talk a little bit generally about some of the things that we're doing in relationship to the city, and then at the end I'd like to talk about some serious things in terms of our community, and hopefully interspersed I'll try and answer some questions. So we can go to the next slide. So as you know, Des Moines is home to Highline College. It's the first community college in King County. It's the most diverse higher education institution in the state. We have 74% students of color. And I think within that group, it's pretty, it's about 20% API, 19% Hispanic, 17% African American, 17% who identify as multiracial, and about 1% Native American. So pretty big, pretty significant percentage. And of course, we're a founding member of Soundside Alliance, which I understand had a great program today, but I was busy doing other things, with a spectacular turnout. And of course, as you all know, we're the home of the Marine Science and Technology Center in beautiful Des Moines and Redondo, and we like to think that it's a real jewel for the college and for the city, because it's not only a place for, we do marine science and environmental science and oceanography, but we do a lot of community education there, and in partnership with K-12, but also just with the community. So next slide, please. So just some demographics there. You can read them. A big chunk of our students actually come from living in Des Moines. Our Running Start program last year was huge. It's probably up more than 10% this year. We serve a pretty good number of international students. On any given day, about 50% of the students in our classrooms are non-native English speakers, which creates some real interesting opportunities for the learning environment. Next slide, please. The college has had a lot of success lately and a lot of national recognition. We've worked with Chronicle of Higher Education, which is the big national publication in higher education, on great colleges to work for, where they come in and, you know, look at your underwear and survey your faculty and staff and whatever. And we've done it 3 years, and we've been recognized all 3 years, including this past year, as a great college to work for. Which, with a great administrative team, always feels really, really good to us. Insight into Diversity is the oldest publication on diversity in the U.S., and for 3 years in a row, we've been recognized for higher education excellence in diversity, where they believe strongly that we are getting some success, not just that we do programming around diversity. And then American Association of Community Colleges, last year we got the National Award for 21st Century Colleges on excellence in diversity related to student success. And then a couple weeks ago at the Tacoma World Trade Center, awarded our Center of Excellence for Global Trade and Supply Chain Management its Service Provider of the Year Global Award, which was pretty cool. We do a lot of programs that are based on some pretty cool grants. We were just one of 10 institutions nationally that was recently awarded an APEASY grant, which focuses on Asian American, Native American, Pacific Islander communities, and of course we're an API serving institution. And just before that, we were awarded for our program ACHIEVE, serving students with intellectual disabilities who are in transition from schools into employment. We've had a national grant on that, and again, I think we're one of four community colleges that got the national grant. It's about $1.8 million over 5 years. We're quite excited about it. It's one of those programs. You heard my colleagues down there talk about serving all the kids and trying to know that all means all, that warehousing students is not really an option. And in those transition programs, working with the school districts where we serve the students, we've had an 82% employment rate for those students. We have a good partnership with Microsoft, among some others like Costco, and getting really good employment. Then the TRIO program, serving disadvantaged students, and MESA, serving first-generation students from disadvantaged economic backgrounds in the science and engineering area. You know, of course, we do a lot of international work and have been recognized internationally. I've had the good fortune, because of the success of my colleagues, to be invited to when the State Department has co-hosted with different countries like India and Indonesia Higher Education Summit. And most recently, a new initiative that we're working on is trying to work with the whole student and coordinate resources, because at a college, you got a student who's doing really well, and then all of a sudden they, like, disappear, and you know, the car quit working or something happened in their life. And so this Working Families Success Network is an effort to work with community-based organizations and offer those services so you can help students, the whole student, and maybe solve some of their problems that the faculty aren't in a position to solve, and not have them lose that term and help them stay in school. And then, of course, we've had some good fortune with some NSF grants on science education. So those are all things that, you know, within the last year have been evident. So I work with great people. It's nice to see that they get acknowledged for their great work, and I think we do really important work in this community. Next slide, please. I always think it's really important that the college is upfront and sees its role in economic development. You know, we have a big transfer program, but we also have a workforce program. But more importantly, we also have resources where we work directly with business, both in microenterprise and the Small Business Development Center. And, you know, Des Moines has been an important part of supporting the Small Business Development Center in its work in our communities. And we always acknowledge that and thank you for that. I think we get good outcomes. We try to stay very accountable in what we do in that, and Start Zone tends to work with the microenterprise, really trying to get somebody up and running, oftentimes someone who's been more a part of the informal economy and, you know, wants to get a real business license and make something work.
Just getting them to put together a business plan when, you know, someone just gets an idea, they want to go into business, yeah. They don't think about what a plan – that they need a plan for 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, to what it's going to look like, and you've provided that.
Yeah, that's important work. And then I always like to highlight the international students, because the international students wouldn't be in this community without the college, you know, or Central Washington University. And just looking at the number of international students we have from last year, looking at the latest data, it's about a $12 million local economic impact. So obviously, that's bigger than Des Moines, but it really is pretty much South King County, where those students, you know, rent, buy their groceries, do all that stuff related to living. You know, like Susan was talking about, cooperative education, internships, great partnerships with the port, particularly the airport, but also the city and other entities. And hopefully that creates a lot of value added in the workforce development. And, of course, we've already talked a little bit about the Center of Excellence. And then we have a real strong program in allied health and the clinical placements. We work very, very closely with what I now call St. Highlines, Highline Hospital. And, you know, that's actually across several different disciplines in allied health, but of course nursing is the one that tends to stand out. Next slide, please.
Out of curiosity, in terms of the clinical, do you have anything that ties in with the services that are provided by CMAR or health?
Yeah, we work with CMAR very closely. We do some bilingual stuff, in particularly in nursing assistant, medical assisting. Documents, particularly looking at records. And then, as you know, we have four now applied bachelor degrees in cybersecurity, trade and logistics, respiratory care, youth development. Because my colleagues here, I want to highlight the trade and logistics, because it's a great partnership, actually, with Central Washington University. So as part of the bachelor program, the students take four courses directly from Central Washington University, which actually allows them to apply for a certificate of completion for that program as a certificate in addition to the bachelor degree that they get from us. So it's a good opportunity to see how higher education institutions actually work together and do value added with one another. So we're excited about those programs. Cybersecurity is a huge high demand thing. Program. I don't know if you're aware of it, but we actually run the student competition for cybersecurity for the Northwest. It's for universities and colleges. And my colleague Amelia Phillips, Dr. Phillips, who oversees that program, is also the director of the student competition from colleges and universities in the Northwest. I believe last year that Boise State won, but usually there's about 15 colleges that participate. We're looking at trying to do a parallel one with international with institutions outside the U.S. We have a lot of international partnerships, and we've been talking about ways that we might be able to do that. Dr. Phillips has been working with the National Security Agency because we're a center of excellence in cybersecurity, and looking at what we can do and who's eligible to play in that. And they've actually been very cooperative and helpful and want to be a participant in helping set that up. So that's been very cool. The competition itself, if you don't know, usually folks like Microsoft and Amazon and a number of the smaller companies send representatives to either do judging or to watch the event. Often we get the military, whether it's the Navy or another agency, to do the attack. And every team has two teams. One team that's really dealing with the cybersecurity, and the other team's trying to keep the business going. Because where you are, people get employed, they need a new email, they need all that stuff. People get unemployed, they need to be off of email. So all those things need to work in concert. So it's a pretty rewarding opportunity, and needless to say, the reason those businesses show up is they get an opportunity to see who's really good at this, and then they poach them very quickly. So that's a program, obviously, that we're very proud of. All four of these programs have been built on areas that have some real strength, and they all started because we had a lot of support in business and industry, or they wouldn't have been approved. We have a couple other programs that are kind of on the front end that are really certificate programs, urban agriculture. You know, we got a little patch on the campus. We're doing some work in the community. We're looking at the potential of expanding that. Particularly a lot of children of immigrants have a real interest there, and some of our adult students as immigrants who came from ag background, they're trying to figure out, so is there a way to make a living or to supplement a living? And then human resources is a program we're working on, again, a certificate program, really short term. And then a new program for us that kind of combines some things that we used to be doing, the two-year degree, that's a two-year degree program, is multimedia design. So there's some things that we're doing. Next slide. Do I have another? Yeah. And then things that we'd like to believe that we're doing that are value added in the community, particularly in this community. I just tried to highlight a few things. I call it soccer diplomacy. One of the interesting things, you know, people are rightfully very interested in attainment. You know, how do we get students to succeed? But we're still in the access business. And we serve a lot of communities that, first of all, don't have a clue what a community college is, because in the country that they may have immigrated from or their parents immigrated from, they didn't have a community college, and they certainly didn't have a college that saw them as part ownership in the institution. And so they don't run for city council. They don't show up at city council meetings usually. They're not in the Chamber of Commerce. They're not in Rotary. And oftentimes they're not as stable as communities. People move in, people move out. And so identifying leadership's not so easy. So we kind of came up with soccer. So we try to get, we do some soccer tournaments kind of built on the UN model, right? We'll do a All Nations or something like that, and we try to highlight, you know, middle school, early high school kids, or sometimes high school kids, but a little bit based on ethnicity associated with nationality. And the key is they also need to bring their parents. And then that way we're able to feed them, introduce them to the college. We partnered with some folks in healthcare and other things so that they're aware of some other services. But it actually gets them in the community, and we're able to begin to engage them in a positive way. So that's what soccer diplomacy is, if you wondered. The first one, the Youth Summit, somebody mentioned Uprise earlier. With, I think it was Susan, serving the Pacific Islander Native Hawaiian community that we hosted at the college. 2 weeks ago, we had the Black and Brown Male Summit. We had about 600 black and brown youth high school kids on campus in collaboration with a lot of school districts, and trying to really focus on a pathway to college, and trying to figure out ways that that's not a one-and-done event, that it's a means to connect with them and follow up with them in school. And, you know, those are really important things. In the spring, we do one for young girls, high school age primarily, called YEL, Young Educated Ladies Leading. Needless to say, I'm not smart enough to have made that title up. It's a great program. So we've expanded that with the new Anna Peasy grant. We have been collaborating in the past with South Seattle, doing one primarily with Southeast Asians and Burmese. So that'll have some additional resources and energy.
Jack, I think Michael had a question.
Just a couple of comments. One, I'm sure the soccer thing had nothing to do with Fred Mendoza. not at all. And second, just two other things. I think you would have been really proud of the breakfast this morning. It was very, very successful.
Yeah, everybody told me it was spectacular.
Yeah, it went great. And the comment I want to make is just kind of echo something that the mayor said, but I think there's really opportunities right now for the workforce development in terms of specific economic development activities happening in the city and in the region. Mm. And that's certainly something I think we'd like to pursue with the college in terms of how that works, you know, and how we can incorporate, you know, Highline in terms of providing some of the expertise and some of the workforce potential for some of these companies that are locating, especially in the business park, but elsewhere as well. So just a comment.
Yeah, no, we welcome those opportunities. So related to community collaborations, and this is kind of the really serious thing, not that the other stuff's not serious, but this is a really serious thing that I, you know, wanted to say, you know, kind of piggybacking on what Susan was talking about, although she's much nicer than me and much, much gentler. You know, we have some real problems in this society, and we have a lot of poverty in South King County, and sometimes I think people are in denial about what our communities look like and how fragile our institutions are. And so these things that we've been doing with youth summits, I think are really important. But what they also do is, if you go to those sessions and you listen to some of our faculty and staff are just amazing in working with the youth in trying to create a voice for them and trying to give them an opportunity to talk about their engagement. You know, they're very much on the edge. We've got to figure out in a very proactive way how to deal with things like Black Lives Matter and take it seriously and not say, ooh, well, that's a particular thing. We've got to figure out a way to be a community resource in a proactive way and work in communities that really creates a pathway so that those youth have a voice, so that it's not we're coming with a solution, we're coming with ears to try and understand how we can be responsive. And I think one of the ways that I hope the college can work with the city, you know, as early as, you know, these little things like soccer diplomacy are good ways to engage at a younger age and in some ways in a positive way to engage, but looking at all kinds of ways that we can work together to try and strengthen what I believe are kind of fragile civil institutions in our society and try and represent those voices and try and be responsive to them. I know the college is really committed to trying to do a better job at being owned by the community, and part of being owned is that so many of our communities end up with a voice in what we are. I mean, we all know that there are 120, 130 languages spoken in the general communities around here, and we need to see those things as positive and engage and build on strengths in those communities rather than talking about what they don't have, and we particularly need to engage youth. So one of the things that I think is real serious that I leave you with tonight is we're real interested also in how do we do that so kids see a future for themselves.
Well, I'm glad you brought this up, because I personally, my, when I saw the demographics, I mean, first you see numbers and then you see people, you know. And when I saw the numbers that came back from the 2010 census, and it talked about 15.3% Hispanic population in Des Moines, which means that we're in the top 25 of all the cities in the state. And you have to think about Yakima and Pasco and White Swan and in Benton County. You have to think about that, and then Burien and Des Moines and Kent and the demographics shift. It'll be interesting to see what the mid-census numbers come back as costs rise in Seattle for housing, particularly rent. It's driving economically disadvantaged people to South County and in part to the East County, but predominantly to the South County because our rents have always been more competitive from a cost perspective. It's changing the demographics, the percentage of African Americans that are moving to South County, not just in Des Moines, but Federal Way, the entire South County area. It's changing the nature of the county. And these are things in terms of being able to outreach to people. Government struggles with to begin with, but when you have these disadvantaged communities or communities that because of the cultural upbringing that they've had have kept government or institutions at arm's length or even further, makes it even harder to engage, which is why I'm really intrigued about this, the particularly the youth summits, the youth outreach programs that you have. That's a great door opening. Our chief has done some good work relative to community outreach in terms of
He's done some really good work.
And all of these things, we need to find a better way to make those connections. But it also means that we as electeds need to get plugged into that so that we're hearing what the concerns are. Because you hear something secondhand or thirdhand, it's not the same thing as hearing it directly from the people who are being affected by it. Mm-hmm. And we're divorced from that. From the population in general, it's a struggle, getting people to pay attention to something unless it's right in their backyard, you know. We struggle with that, and we're not the only city. All jurisdictions are. But because of the nature, because of the challenges that we have, because of the language differences, because of the economic impacts, because of the cultural differences, we need to find better ways to be able to engage with the people who we're representing and figuring out what those needs are, how best to meet them, what unique ways to meet them. And the more people, the more solutions, you know, the more conversation, the more solutions that you get to talk about. So I'm actually glad you brought this up because it's been something that's been on my radar for a while. And there's no easy or obvious thing. You have that ability because you bring in a diversity of students, the very nature of the people who come to the campus. Which is why you're an incredible asset for the city. And the city hasn't done the best job of being able to take advantage of that, and at the same time, you're being able to get what you need from the city in the same breath. So I'd like to find out what types of things work for you that maybe the city should be doing, or maybe the college should be the point for making that happen, and we avail ourselves of participating or attending or whatever it is to help facilitate that interaction, that engagement.
Yeah, the college sometimes has the blessing of being the neutral ground, which is truly, truly a blessing. But, I mean, you know, one of the issues that, you know, we struggle with at the college is not to see diversity as a program, but to see it as an identity. When you're 74% students of color, it's who you are. It's not just a demographic statistic. And trying to embrace that and see that as part of your identity and then serve those communities It's not easy, but it's important.
When a third of the people in Des Moines are people of color, and yet are not the people who are engaging with their government, with their schools, with their, and schools seem to be the one place where they are, where there's a comfort level, where either at the K-12 level or through the colleges have done a good job because they're coming to you. That's the kind of connection that needs to happen at the city level as well. And so to whatever degree that we can participate, that you're willing to foster or host or be the meeting ground for that engagement, I think that's something that we need to do.
Yeah.
So,
well, the two things that the college always hopes to be is neutral ground in the positive sense associated with economic development. If we can bring people together, business, government, about what's possible to grow the economy, you know, in Southwest King County, you know, we want to be both a participant in its success, but also if we can host that so that it's not sort of any city getting a competitive advantage by hosting it or whatever might be thought of. And this whole other important issue about community engagement and being a resource and a venue for safe community engagement is real important to us. And I guess those were the two issues that I wanted to leave you with tonight, and in ways that we may work together most successfully as we try to do things in the, you know, tomorrow and in the future. Because as I see our community, those are things that we really need to be successful at. And as Mike was saying, it's nice to, on the economic development side, to see such a great event that happened today with such a great turnout, as I understand. So, thank you.
Any other questions, Council? Thanks. And sorry to put you on last, but
no worries.
It's been a...
We just kind of went up the wrong.
Sure. Exactly. That's the pathway we have, so that works. That works. Thank you again for the invitation. My name is Lucas Rux. I am the regional director for Central Washington University. There are four of us in the state. Most immediately, I'm charged with the University Center right here in the community on the Highline campus. Regionally, historically, my role has been to work with community colleges. We're the 2+2 model, so transfers. Going forward, goals for this year, public higher ed is not good at tooting their own horn, letting people know what we're doing locally. And so I still have a big challenge. People don't understand what programs we have right in the neighborhood. So we are going to get much more involved, advisory committees, local industry, business, that kind of thing. This is a perfect outreach example here for me tonight. We're not gonna leave our community colleges by any means, but we need to do more, I think, earlier to promote what we're doing right here. So very casual overview from me tonight. I am fine with interjections. This is a perfect format. I just kind of wanted to outline the population we're serving, kind of the model that Central has statewide, and then give you kind of a quick rundown of challenges, opportunities for the upcoming year. So currently we have 630 students. My population really is Dr. Birmingham's population, sometimes immediately and then sometimes a couple years down the road. Very diverse student body. Of those 630 students, we have 510 full-time equivalency. So that's a little bit different than the part-time community college commuter student. Most of my students are evening students, which is also a big difference. And that is a tribute to the work at Highline and the other CTCs. They are, 95% of them are working in the daytime, and then they're coming to my classes 4, 5, 6 o'clock starts. So you can imagine, a lot of us have the traditional 18-year-old in mind. We think about university students. It isn't the case really at any of our university centers at Central. Average age is 31 this quarter, and that's the bulk of our students are late 20s, early 30s, their parents, their full-time jobs. University research, we know that if you work more than 19 hours a week,
your grades are going to suffer. And that's the majority of my students. So the challenges are very real. We are talking about a food pantry. We are talking about piloting bus pass programs. We don't really have a resource for daycare, but we share resources for veterans and for those kinds of services. Highline is very gracious in hosting us, so we're able to collaborate pretty often on that. Our students primarily are place-bound because they have decent jobs in the region. Certainly there are those international students. There are some students where I'm their second choice. They all thought they were pre-med at UW, and that didn't work out. I'm okay with being a number two. But a lot of our students, they are the late 20, early 30 working adults. They like the community, and they aren't able to get a bachelor's unless it's because of Central. I do think our model is the best. Cost-effective. We have a great resource in our community. Right on the same campus, you can get some of those soft skills. You've got the technical training, and now you're able to advance your career through management and leadership opportunities. Yesterday, we had new student orientation. 110 new students are planning to start with us in January, so that's up. Usually, January start is about 80 or 90. Our freshman enrollment in Ellensburg is up, and our university centers are up, too, so it's good for us. 35 faculty are in my building every week. Another difference that we have versus other branch campuses or university centers, the majority of mine are full-time PhD tenure track. I don't think we do enough in the community promoting and celebrating that. A lot of times, I don't know if there's anybody in the room, but the for-profits, some of the other types of industries, they are part-timers and they're working for many places at once. That isn't the model in this community. So I think having people that live in the community that are devoted to research and educating our residents, I think that's a big plus that we need to celebrate. We have 10 student services staff. It really is a mini university, everything from advising and financial aid and counseling. I guess I kind of simplified tonight's presentation, but I don't think that people know what we have right here in the community. And then, of course, we have three support staff. The model that Central has set up, it's different than Washington State. It's different than some of the for-profits. The 2+2 model, we are focusing on community college students in their first 2 years and then helping them with their advising get to us as fast as possible. There is a goal statewide. The governor has an initiative to increase baccalaureate attainment. We're doing our part with that. We have university centers right here, of course, is the largest in the state. Linwood, Pierce County, Everett, Moses Lake, Wenatchee, and Yakima. So we've got 7 of these models around the state. We have teaching sites, Walla Walla, Renton Tech, and Grays Harbor. Recruitment, most of the students in this community, they're coming to us from Highline, South Seattle, Seattle Central, Green River, Renton Tech, Bellevue, Tacoma, and Pierce Puyallup. Some of these are returning students. They are working locally, but a lot of them are direct transfers right from the community colleges. I'm going to give you my grocery list just because I don't think people know the opportunities here. We have bachelor's degrees in accounting, business administration. We have minors in sports, business, and business administration. We are the teacher's college. We've been doing this forever. The I-5 corridor, nobody is more represented than Central, and I don't think people know that. The majority of our K-12 teachers are from Central. So, of course, we have early childhood, we have elementary ed, we do middle-level math, we do TESOL. Of course, we do the social sciences, we have IT, we have administrative management, law and justice, psychology. We've got a couple graduate programs all revolving around either accounting or teaching. And we have a master's in law and justice. We have a variety of online programs. We never compete with, Dr. Birmingham's gone, we never compete with him. We do collaborate on things. Sometimes I'm getting students from other regions because of that no-compete clause. So I have students from Pierce, I have students from Linwood because of things offered on the other community college. So it truly is a good relationship to be celebrated.
Let me ask a question.
Sure.
I know that Highline for a number of years has had a hospitality mm-hmm. Program. Do you partner to complete?
We don't. You don't. We have explored, we have a tourism, hospitality, and trade program, and they have talked, and it hasn't gone. We're going to get there, some of my challenges, but we haven't partnered with them yet. Yep. I know there's some local development happening, too, and hotel talks, and we haven't talked about a program or a short-term certificate that's coming to my campus yet. Yeah. And that really gets to kind of starting the discussion for me, where I kind of wanted to leave tonight. Challenges immediate. State funding. 3 years ago, my institution, 80% of our annual operating budget came from the state. Today, less than 15% of our operating budget comes from the state, meaning it's all tuition driven. If we have a down year, if we're short 100 students, it impacts the university. We don't have an endowment like UW. You know, there's nothing really to fall back on.
So what do you do when the legislature reduces your tuition?
Right, right. We are as, I think we're healthy. We are as lean and as efficient as you can be. If we get cut again, we're in trouble. We're talking tenured jobs. We really are.
You'll be happy to know that as part of our intergovernmental policies that we'll wind up adopting, I think, next week. Yeah. That we added advocacy on behalf of the colleges of the state to make sure that you're getting the funding that you need to be able to operate.
Sure. You know, on my side of the house, it is tough. The first things that you cut, you can't cut classes, so you cut services. And with my population, it really hurts. We have many people who are doing two and three different functions, and then we rely on the community college support. I mean, it really is a partnership. If we're cut anymore, that last little 15%, it would impact us. It really would. New funding model means a new kind of operating mindset, responsibility-centered management, which is good. The university, every decision that we're making now, cut the waste. It's a little bit challenging for the branch campus in that I really believe in the more options that we have, the more programs that I can sell to the community, I think they will all rise. And so when I have programs that are basing every decision on how many seats will you guarantee, unfortunately, I saw Yakima cut so that Des Moines could have a program because they thought, well, there's a bigger population. This community is going to feel that too because Linwood, Edmonds, there's a lot of students up there. And so it's almost like that we're competing with ourselves now. They don't want to spread. I mean, PhDs are expensive. They don't want to spread faculty too thin. And we'll get into how you guys can help me with some of that too. Brand awareness, again, a lot of people are starting to know that we're here. I still have students that think we're only an admission center or we're only a service center. They don't understand that you can fully earn a bachelor's in the community. I work in the port or, you know, eventually the Gretchen Shoebox thing. I have this technical skill, but in order to be management, I need a bachelor's. I don't care what it's in. I still get those. It's like we have so many things that you should care what it's in because we have opportunities for you.
Just out of curiosity.
Yeah.
Even, you know, driving down 240th.
Yep.
There's no central signage. You have to look over and see, there's the building. Now, I look because I know it's
there. Yep. There is a new sign. The old Highline signs are blue. The new one's brown. It's on 240th. It's only in white block letters, but it does say Central Washington University. So that's new. Last couple months, that's been put up. But, no, I agree. Some of it's probably higher ed issues. I am envious of Edmonds. They've got big red Wildcat signs. I mean, you know there's a university on the campus. And we
can't negotiate that.
Yeah. I wish Dr. Birmingham was still here. No. We're very good, and they are gracious. We have some great signs once you're in our building, but no, you're right. Some of the other campuses around the state, they actually have freeway signs, and they have the street signs, and this community, I'm fairly new in this role. We just haven't got there yet.
Which begs a bigger question, which is the capacity of Highline physically to accommodate whatever your future is, and whether or not you need a separate but nearby campus, whether you need your own campus somewhere else in the community. I mean, I don't know, but I'm curious what your long term needs are.
Capacity building, we're talking about it. There aren't classroom spaces available on the Highline campus in the time slots where either the departments want them or where the students need them. We are having to look at Fridays and weekends. There's plenty of space on the weekends, but sometimes I can't get students, and then sometimes I can't get teachers on those days. So there are challenges there. We don't have the discussion going on right now in Ellensburg about a standalone campus. I know that And that's going to be a challenge in the future. I know Federal Way is very interested in that, and they've got space picked out for that. And I know that there's been discussions
we'd
on
like
that.
We'd like to keep you here, of course.
Exactly. We believe in the 2+2 model, but that means there's going to be another public competitor. There will be a draw for those 18-year-olds if there's something in the neighborhood that I can't meet. That's very true. We talked about the academic buy-in from the departments, the budget cuts. I need more input from the community, from our leaders. I can do so much with graduate data and economic forecasting, but we invite everybody to the building, to the center. I've got some events here I'll highlight, but I think you know, one person barking isn't nearly as great as a room full of people. So I need we're going to do a better job of soliciting feedback, but I need that. And certainly I will put you in touch with decision makers way above me when it comes to offering more.
I think there are a lot of central graduates that live in our community, whether they went to Ellensburg or whatever, that would be great cheerleaders and great promoters for Central's services here in Des Moines. Mm-hmm. And finding a way to be able to market that would go a long ways.
Yeah.
It would elevate your the perception of Central within the community, and it would actually help bolster Highline, I think, as well.
Right. Last kind of challenge to highlight, and it piggybacks on some of the things we talked about, but the university knows math and English readiness. If it's a struggle junior year of high school, it's a barrier to the bachelor degree. So we are all for Cambridge, AP, IB. Running Start on Highline, we have a college and the high school model. I love talking about it. I know sometimes there is a gray area of competing with our friends, but the university knows that students that find success in math early will translate to bachelor success. And so we are all, I think somebody asked that question. There's a great study out of Oregon. Students that completed university math as a junior or senior were slightly more likely to earn their bachelor's than the counterparts that went into the traditional freshman math. So anybody that says they're too young or they're too immature or it doesn't carry over, it's not true. I want to replicate the study here in Washington State because we've done this long enough now with Running Start in college and the high school to have a good sample size. But the earlier we can get them to level at math, the more likely they will be to earn the degree. So I applaud the AB and IB pathways. College and the high school, we're all over. We're not as strong in Highline and Federal Way, but we're Puyallup and Kent and Tacoma. We're all over the region. So I'm always up for talking about that too. Opportunities, new programs coming to the area, special ed. There is worry. I think the jobs are there. I don't know if they're students. There are school districts that are hiring, and so there's worry. I think this is coming fall 2016. I'll start to market this March and April. We've started letting our school partners know. We get calls. Do you have anybody that's available in the Puyallup area or in the Tacoma area? And because we're not doing it yet, I don't. There's worry that there's going to be students that are going to stick with the traditional track and not want special ed. So the department's very leery. Let's just try one cohort and see how it goes. Public health is also coming fall of 16. So I'll have a bachelor's in public health right here in the community. Those are the two bachelor programs. The other charge I have, we are going to really broaden our continuing ed offering. That means a lot of things to a lot of different people. Number one, enrichment programs. In your binder, I did stick the beer certificate in there. That was really just to make you curious. We do over in Ellensburg. We're going to start to offer some home brewing classes. We're going to start to do some craft brewing classes starting at Pierce and hopefully up this way soon. We're looking for community interaction, and this isn't just the university building it and putting it out there. We're looking to partner with local business, arts commissions, those kinds of things. Enrichment for the community, whether we're building a customized Microsoft Office for a local business class offering, or we're partnering with credit unions, or it's purely enrichment. we want to start to expand. I love the multiversity approach. And even though we're small, we are finally lean enough to and nimble enough to where we can start to do some of those things. So I'll be soliciting continuing ed opportunities too in the near future. Short-term certificates, we touched on the supply chain. We would like to do more of that. There is some change and some growth coming to the area, and so we'd like to build some short-term certificates that aren't being offered yet. There's no point in competing, but we're looking at 3 to 7 month certificates. We're entertaining all proposals now, which since I've been with the university, this is the first time we're doing that. So it's kind of an exciting time, a little scary too, but we're getting there. Community events, two things I wanted to highlight. We talked a little bit Black Lives Matter. The theme, we have a committee, that was their name, and it has evolved and changed so many times, I don't know if they have a name. But the theme this year, we are looking at mass incarceration. And so late March, early April, we are conducting research right now in the state on disenfranchisement, on disparity of sentencing. And we're gonna have some community events late March, early April. Public forum, we've got some UW speakers, we've got some from Central coming in, but we're gonna do more to involve the community.
You should touch base with King County Councilmember Dave Upthegrove, who has been pushing for a look at issues related to this relative to King County.
Perfect.
And it ties into the replacement for the youth detention center that they have there. The size of facility that they're talking about building.
Perfect.
And other things like that, but they're looking at ways to address that issue, and he's plugged in on that. In fact, I think they have an ordinance that they're considering related to
perfect
issues on that.
Perfect. I've got an art exhibit coming. We're going to do some poster presentations, and I've only got two speakers so far, so I'll use any recommendation. Thank you. That's late March, early April, and then in January we have our Sports Marketing Summit open to the community. It's a fun day, and we do a terrible job of telling people about it. We have the Seahawks, the Sounders, the Mariners, the Storm, Seattle U, and one of the minor league baseball teams in Oregon. It's their marketing side, so Marshawn Lynch is not showing up. But it that's right. That's right. The guy that sells you the ticket to the game will be there. But it is a really
this is in March?
No. This one is in January.
January.
Yeah, but it's right on the Highline campus. And I'll start sending out emails. We got posters already printed. It's a fun forum, kind of behind the scenes sports marketing, how to get into that. We do invite the Skill Center. We invite the local high schools. Traditionally, it's mostly the college business students from Highline and from Central. A couple of Green River students will come over, but it's open to the public, and that's a really fun day where people, they don't even know that Central's good at sports marketing. We've got a great relationship with the Seahawks.
Sure.
Perfect. Thank you. So those are the kind of the two community events. We're not going to abandon the bachelor's degree by any means or the college partnerships, but we can do a lot more local focus. So that's my direction. That's my vision going forward. I think that was really it in a nutshell. We want to be much more open. We want to host events. I have space, non-traditional time, weekends, nights, Fridays, that we can host meetings and nonprofits. We are putting together a leadership certificate. It's going to revolve around volunteerism, getting involved. So I will certainly invite you to those. I need lots of speakers for those. Just like we know our student government leaders become Fortune 500 leaders and church leaders and government agency leaders, we also know that local volunteerism translates into public service. And so I've got a 4-week certificate. I don't have dates yet. We're just starting to build this thing. But, how do we get involved? How do we become active in local government? Those kinds of things. We don't have enough people, I think, that are aware of that. So we're going to try and host some of those too.
A lot of volunteer and community-based organizations struggle to get members, you know, to join, whether it's Rotary or the upcoming Kiwanis that's trying to get started again, and some others. And just finding ways to be able to, so that people even know what even exists, is a huge step forward.
Yep.
So that's great.
Yep. Last thing I wanted to highlight, we are starting to pilot teacher academies. They weren't represented here in the room tonight. We're looking at Tacoma, Puyallup, and Kent. These are grow-your-own models. And I don't know them well enough to ask, but some of the smaller districts, they feel like they get poached and stolen from. And so they really want to look at an academy in the high school with a running start or a college in the high school model. They go to the community college and become paraeducators. Then they come right to Central and they do their certification, their bachelor's with us. They have a student teaching job in the high school. Then they have a guaranteed hire in the high school. And so it's really a grow your own model. We're going to start to pathway this, pilot this in the fall.
Counseling, Vic.
Yeah, thanks for the presentation. On your with your graduates, what kind of placement programs do you offer, or services do you offer, and what percentages do you have that get into
sure.
your field of choice?
Yeah, so I have a career services counselor right in the building. We start that early with, I think we do a great job with internships, forced internships. It's part of every bachelor's degree. From this community all the way down to government agencies in Olympia. We have several career fairs. Our big focus really is the College of Business. So I think last week we had 20 accounting CPA type agencies from here to Seattle that we hosted. I think we do a very good job. I don't know employment numbers. I could certainly email those to you. But we have a staff in place on campus. We work with Boeing, Amazon, REI, several of our small manufacturers that are interested in the IT and cybersecurity. I have those minors. I don't have the bachelor's, but we still have those employers coming for our skills.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay. Well, thank you.
Thank
appreciate
you.
Appreciate you being here. And
I think it was 8:18.
Yeah. yeah. Daylight savings time. We greatly appreciate you being here, and I appreciate everybody. And to the degree that there's something that we can help you with,
yes.
please don't hesitate to contact sure. us. Education, whether K-12 or higher education, is extremely important to our community. It's a basis for the economic engine in terms of training the people who are going to be doing the jobs that keep the economy running and make our city successful. To the degree that we're able to help with things where there are creative mm-hmm. solutions to problems the city has, we want to hear, you know, like I said earlier, the more people we hear from, the better in terms of problem solving and addressing issues. That's the end of our regular agenda. There is one community
a citizen who came in just a few minutes later. He has a quick announcement about a community event she'd like you to know about.
Good evening, council members. My name is Tina Smith, and I am the president of Northwest Associated Arts. I would here to invite you personally, all the council members, staff, and community leaders here, to the local presentation by Northwest Associated Arts of our holiday concert, Joy, which will feature all of our ensembles. We have 7 ensembles that are comprised of 200 singers, ranging in age from 8 to 80. This is an intergenerational family event that I hope you will all look into. I'm going to leave some information so you can learn more about Northwest Associated Arts. On an evening where you're discussing education, that is our mission and vision, is to provide musical education to everyone in the South Sound community. So I encourage you to check us out. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you. With that, we are at the end of our agenda. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Councilmember Netting, second by Councilmember Pennington. All those in favor, raise your hand and say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Our next council meeting is next week, December 10th. On the consent agenda are consultant contracts for Lynn Madsen and Grant Fredericks, public defender contract, reappointment to Senior Services Advisory Committee, draft ordinance regarding one-time revenues, 2016 intergovernmental policies and positions, transportation gateway project, supplement agreement for additional right-of-way services. And then under old business is the Parks and Rec and Senior Services Master Plan, which we will be considering for approval, and the 2016 City Council Vision, Mission, Goals, and Strategic Objectives, which we previously reviewed and will make any last-minute changes and approve. So with that, we are adjourned.